Hello, everybody, and welcome to Action and Adventure, the Hasbro Universe podcast. Today, we have something very special for you guys. We have an interview with the one, the only, Brandon Easton, writer of such TV shows as Agent Carter and Transformers, and comics like Andre the Giant, Transformers Deviations, and of course, what pertains to our show most importantly, M.A.S.K., Mobile Armored Strike Kommand. So please, ladies and gentlemen, and non-binary folks everywhere, put your hands together for the one, the only, Mr. Brandon Easton. Brandon, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Now, you have talked a lot about on social media about how you're a huge Transformers nerd. But I want to ask, were you a M.A.S.K. fan when you got started?
Yeah, I mean, I watched M.A.S.K. in its original run. Obviously, it didn't have the same impact for me as Transformers and G.I. Joe and Thundercats and Voltron and Robotech did, but I definitely watched M.A.S.K. The later seasons got really, really silly, so it wasn't something that I was particularly, as I was getting older, I was moving into high school when that was really starting to hit. So for me, I was into it for a while, but after about the second season, I was just like, as I was moving into, high school, M.A.S.K. kind of fell in the background, as a lot of 80s action adventure cartoons did. But when I had heard that, IDW was going to be, rebooting it for their Revolution Universe, I was really excited because I felt that M.A.S.K. could be adapted in a way that wasn't a parody, but could be a really cool action adventure science fiction, comic book. And when they invited me to pitch for it, I was like stunned and very happy and pleased with what they had laid out for me. And we did the IDW, creative summit last year, in the middle of last year. And that was awesome. And to be a part of that, even with my limited fan base or fandom from the past, it was just amazing to contribute to a Hasbro universe. And it was great, and looking back at it, I'm glad that I had the opportunity, and I'm also glad that they asked me, and it was fantastic. And yeah, I mean, I enjoyed it when I was a kid. I was much more of a fan of the first season more so than anything else, because as it went on, it just wasn't the same cartoon. It got really, really dumb, to be absolutely honest, and I wasn't really a big fan of that. But like I said, season one, I was definitely into it, and I loved the toys, so, that's what really kept me in.
Yeah, well, I was not of the generation of M.A.S.K., and so I really only went back to it once, this whole revolution started, and I was like, I want to see some of the source material, and it's like,
yeah,
oh, wow, that is
problematic.
It ranges, I feel like there's times where it's like, it's so cringy, but then there's sometimes where it gets so bad it's hilarious,
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, you are correct. You are very that's a fair assessment.
Yeah, because there are times where it's just like you just have to like laugh at how ridiculous some of it is. But so you had previously done Transformers Deviations.
Yes.
And that led to the M.A.S.K. job, right?
Yes.
So how did you sort of get in with IDW for Deviations?
Okay, well, a couple of years ago, and I want to say it could have been 2014. I don't remember, but there was the BotCon or whatever it's called, that was in Pasadena, California. It was the big Transformers convention. And that year, John Barber and Margaret Scott and I think James Roberts and a few other people who were part of the, you know, all the post All Hail Megatron stuff for IDW was at this convention. And a couple of good friends of mine were connected to John Barber, who at the time, number one, was the editor, and two, was still, you know, still writing a ton of Transformers stuff. So we were introduced, we connected, we talked, you know, I gave him my information, and I think I might have sent some of my stuff to him. And that was, like I said, it was in, it was definitely in 2014 now that I think back to it, because almost an entire year went by before I heard back from John, and I got this email in the middle of nowhere. I mean, it just came out of the blue saying, hey, you know, would you like to pitch a Transformers Deviations comic? And I was just blown away that he remembered me after all that time and that they actually, you know, pulled me out of, you know, out of the ether to do this. And they really enjoyed the Deviations book, which I enjoyed writing. And from there, they actually invited me to pitch several things, but M.A.S.K. was the like number one thing on that list that I pitched that they liked. And we went from there.
So can you tell us any of the other pitches, or are those like, or is that like NDA?
Oh, no. I mean, this is fun. I mean, I pitched Judge Dredd. I pitched Micronauts. And I can't remember what it, I swear to God, I cannot remember the third thing. But, oh, yeah, I remember. I was pitching a, what's his name? The guy that that created the Justified universe. Oh, my God. What's his name? Elmore Leonard. There was some Elmore Leonard comics that IDW was going to do, and I was pitching some Elmore Leonard concepts. And out of all of that stuff, they chose M.A.S.K. as the one that they liked the most, and that's what I went with. And I'm a big Judge Dredd fan, and I was really hoping I would get a hold of that, and that didn't happen. So it was just one of those things I really enjoyed doing, and it was a blast. I mean, I said, the fact that they even allowed me to pitch all that stuff was amazing. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, Judge Dredd is kind of, you know, he's one of those coveted characters that, like, you know, almost everybody wants to work on, you know, like Superman or something.
Mm-hmm.
In many respects. All right, so you're rebooting M.A.S.K., but at the same time, you're launching it not just in a shared universe, but out of a very specific event. What was sort of the development process like? You know, sort of like, how did you go about, like, saying, okay, we can use this, we can, you know, add this in, that kind of thing?
Sure. The first thing to go back to is the creative summit that we did at IDW mid 2016. We were all, and by we I mean Aubrey Citizen and Margaret Scott and John Barber and David Hedgecock and the Chris Ryall, like Christos Gage, the whole creative team, all the writers and a couple of the editors. We all converged at IDW, and we sat down and mapped out everything that was going to happen. And we generally mapped out, I guess, the core stuff, which would be Transformers and G.I. Joe, because those, you know, obviously are like the kind of the core books. And then Micronauts and ROM, which was, you know, obviously being launched as a heavy, heavy chunk of the Revolution backstory that was coming out. So M.A.S.K. had to fit into all of that. And my personal feeling was that M.A.S.K. should stay a little bit away from the rest of that, because we need to establish who these people are, establish their adventures, establish their universe, so to speak, or their status quo, without stepping on anybody else's toes or having anybody else stepping on ours. So I wanted to have an adventure where they figure out that Venom and the members of Venom are still alive, or they exist at all. And I wanted to do a thing where Matt Tracker is still learning how to be a leader. And that was pretty much the core of the first five issues, where I wanted him to deal with what it means to be a leader and learn how to bounce back from mistakes and learn how to always have a plan B, C, and D. And that's basically how it worked out. It wasn't a thing where, I mean, we did have to pick and choose which characters from various other books may cross over into ours, but I actively resisted that at first because I didn't want a lot of Transformers showing up at first. I didn't want G.I. Joe members showing up quite yet. I wanted the M.A.S.K. team just to have their time as a book. And I got that, obviously. you know, it wasn't until I'd say the end of issue 5 where we started to have things push in from the outside world. And in issue 6 and 7, which was the origin of Venom, you know, we had G.I. Joe characters show up, or G.I. Joe villains show up, and the rest is history, as they say.
Yeah, that actually brings up a good point that I wanted to ask. In this shared universe, you have, you know, the 10-year-plus history of Transformers, but then you also have all the IDW Joe output. Did you go back and, like, what was your research like? Like, did you go back and read a lot of the Joe output and Transformers output that previously had been done?
Well, I was already reading the Transformers books. I mean, those were already kind of in my wheelhouse, so that was already a thing. G.I. Joe, I was told to look at certain runs, not all of it, because some stuff would inform the Revolution universe, but a lot of it didn't. So I needed to be aware of which characters from the outside of M.A.S.K. I was choosing, which Transformers and G.I. Joe characters I wanted to use, which I did choose a couple. We didn't get to use too many of the Transformers or any of the Transformers, unfortunately, but we definitely pulled in the G.I. Joe gang. So I had to make sure I knew the history of certain G.I. Joe characters so that when they came into M.A.S.K., there was a logic behind it. I just didn't want people just showing up for any reason. They needed to be a series of connective tissues, so as they say, to justify these people showing up.
So, and you know, and Mindbender was definitely the big one in the Revolution. There's actually something that actually was confusing for a lot of fans, because he's referred to by two different names, and I was wondering if you could clarify, because he was previously established to have the name Armand Singh, and then was called Verstal Bender, and that was pretty confusing until the Hasbro Heroes sourcebook, you know, eventually like kind of said, oh, it's just you know, him under a different name. Was that a plan, or was that an error that became story?
I honestly don't know, because from what I understood, years ago he was called Dr. Singh, and then he became Dr. Bender. I don't know about why that change was made, actually, because there was a lot of things that was going on all at one time that I wasn't privy to. There was a lot of things happening that I wasn't aware of, particularly leading into First Strike. So in a way, I was in a little bit of a, I guess I had blinders on, so to speak, or I was in a little corner that wasn't always aware of everything else that was going on. So actually, I don't know why that decision was made on the editorial level, but you know, I guess in some ways it may be an error, at least on some creators' parts, by sometimes calling him one name and sometimes calling him another. But that happens sometimes. I mean, it could have been that was just a legitimate short-term error that, you know, unfortunately we didn't get a chance to fix.
Yeah. Well, it was later corrected in the trade, and now, of course, you know, the Hasbro source book turned an error into a, you know, plot point. So, you know, that's the kind of fun thing that can sometimes come from errors, is when you can actually use those errors to inform a new story.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So were there any challenges that you faced rebooting M.A.S.K. into this shared universe?
I mean, the original challenge for me was looking at the original cartoon series, animated series, and figuring out what to pull from that so that it would fit into the Revolution world without it, like I said, being self-parodying or being so incredibly silly that people would just tune out of it. And what I tried to do was bring in the Fast and the Furious motif, in the sense that you have vehicular-based combat and a team of diverse heroes basically fighting villains and also trying to safeguard their personal lives while safeguarding the world. It's very much similar to the Fast and the Furious franchise, which ultimately the theme of that is family. And what I wanted to really, particularly in the first 5 issues, really establish is the family-like nature of both M.A.S.K. and Venom. I wanted people to see that they weren't just a bunch of folks who just end up together, that there's reasons why they care for each other. And coming up with the backstory and linking it all together and having it move forward as a cohesive story, that was really the trick. So I wanted to make sure that every single character in M.A.S.K., anybody who showed up in those pages, had a real backstory that contributed to the decisions they made in the comic. And that's why I think I'm most proudest of issues 6 and 7 because I was given this wide latitude to dig into the psychological and sociological backgrounds of the Venom characters. So they would have reasons why they behaved the way that they did. One thing I cannot stand in comics, movies, television, whatever, novels, is villains who are just bad for bad sake. That is incredibly lazy writing. It's kind of dumb. It's silly. And it shortchanges the audience. I wanted to have even Miles Mayhem have a reason for behaving the way that he behaves. Yeah. And I think that was my ultimate challenge overall.
All right. Yeah, it's interesting that you bring up sort of villains having, you know, not just being cookie cutter villains, because I think when it comes to Mask especially, I mean, you got a dude literally named Miles Mayhem.
Right.
You know, and so, yeah, it's very easy to just make him the blast it tracker, you know,
exactly,
mustache twirling villain. But, you know, and I really liked that you really did dig into the Venom background of those characters, because we really didn't get any of that in the original cartoon.
Nope. Nothing. You got nothing. I mean, you got casual mentions of backstory, but generally speaking, no, you did not get a fundamentally well, thoroughly researched and explained reason why anybody did anything evil.
Yeah. It's just, I mean, he's named Miles Mayhem. What more do you need?
What else? Exactly. What else do you need, right?
Yeah. Which, that's good for an 80s cartoon. Not so much a 2016 comic. So.
No.
Yeah. Now, there was a lot of changes that you made from the original source material to the new ones. Either minor ones like changing the names of certain masks, or in the case of, like, you know, making Bruno Shepard a cyborg, or mm-hmm. the big one that has unfortunately gotten a lot of flack was Matt Tracker. And I'm wondering, mm-hmm. you know, why was it important to you to make Matt an African-American rather than, because what I've seen in fandom a lot is people mm-hmm. just saying, why didn't they make Hondo the leader? Why didn't, you know, they just use X character or change X character? You know, why was it important specifically to make, for you, to make mm-hmm. Matt a black man rather than just, you know, using Hondo or changing right. some other random character?
Okay. Well, I'll tell you this much. And it wasn't, first of all, I got to answer this question properly, we have to go back a little bit. Number one, Hasbro, the multinational corporation, had every final say about anything I did. There was nothing I could do without Hasbro's go ahead or thumbs up, all right, or green light, whatever you want to put it, however you want to put it, right? Yeah. So first things first, Hasbro said they did not want another cookie cutter white male hero. Now, I could have easily used Matt Tracker as we know him, the one that kind of looks like a Hitler youth, but I chose to not do that because I was given, in a sense, carte blanche to remake the team as I saw fit. Now, personally, for me, for Brandon Easton, I am number one African-American writer. I've been a fan of this stuff since I was a child. I grew up not seeing very many black male characters, African-American men or women, in leadership positions. There are very few cartoons where you even had people of color in leadership positions. And I kind of feel that, for me, it's nice to have, from time to time, an African-American male character not be a sidekick. And I want them to not be the guy who they elevate. I wanted Matt Tracker, the hero, to be an African-American man. That was my choice. And Hasbro went along with it. I know
they liked it so much that they made a toy of it.
Exactly. I mean, that's huge. So for me, it wasn't like some unilateral decision I made and, you know, threw caution to the wind and said, screw everybody, this is what I'm doing. It was at least for me, a long thought process. It wasn't something I just decided to do as a lark. I felt that there is, because this is something, I think this is going to touch on something I always talk about, which is nostalgia versus reality, okay? Yeah. For me, as a hardcore Transformers fan, Generation 1, one of those G1 lunatics out there, you know, it's taken a lot for me after many, many years of soul searching to realize that ultimately these properties are constructed to sell toys. They're selling toys. Yeah. As much as I care about the characters and love the characters, I don't own them. And I had an experience at San Diego Comic-Con 1999 where I met the head writer of Beast Wars, Bob Skerr, or Robert Skerr, I believe his name is. And I went to the Beast Wars panel, and I was sitting there the entire time charged up because I was angry with the fact that Optimus Prime was a monkey and that Megatron was a T-Rex and the animation looked horrible. And I was just ready to just give it to him. You know, I was just like, yeah, you know, I'm ready gonna just throw it out there. You know, ultimately, you know, after the panel, I talked to the guy and I told him, you know, and I was, you know, calm, but I was just like, look, you know, I'm a fan of the original show. Why did you guys make this decision? Why did you make that? And he just said, look, I get where you're coming from, but Hasbro makes the decisions. It's my job to implement what Hasbro wants, and I did that. And whether or not it's going to upset, you know, fans out there, they weren't concerned with that. They were concerned with creating a new generation of toys that would get the next generation of young viewers and fans. And that's what it did. And I had to realize that at that moment in 1999 that I had no control over what multinational corporations do, and I had to let it go a little bit. So for me, the way that I protest is I don't spend money on it and I don't talk about it. I realize that these large corporations, generally speaking, are not going to listen to a small but vocal contingent of fans most of the time. No matter what we think, Michael Bay will still make Transformers movies, generally speaking. I mean, even if this one was so-called, the last one was so-called a so-called flop, it still made enough money to legitimize Michael Bay's next installment if he so chooses to do one. So me being mad about it, what's that going to do? You know, it's not going to change Michael Bay. It's not going to change Paramount or DreamWorks. It's not going to stop Hasbro from creating those toys for, you know, it's like it's not going to make a difference. All it does is serve to make me angry and ultimately troll other people who aren't enjoying themselves. So in all of that, I feel that some people just have to calm down about that. I mean, the nostalgia of it, I think a lot of us, and I'll admit to this, you know, I probably unfairly in my own youth attached too many positive feelings to a toy line, you know, and it took me many years to get out of that. And I'm still a fan of the property and franchise, but I don't get mad about it anymore. I don't get upset. I don't feel like creating petitions online saying that, oh, let's get rid of Michael Bay. No, Michael Bay is a very, very rich man who lives in a very, very nice community in a big, giant house. Trust me, he does not care about anything that G1 fans feel about Transformers. And I feel that, and I'm not being arrogant about it, because, I mean, I do listen to fans and I do talk to people at conventions and stuff. But ultimately, as a creator, I have to listen to what I want to do and what I want to say. And I don't think changing Matt Tracker from a white guy to an African-American guy was so egregious to deserve the amount of backlash it got. I mean, there are many worse things in the world to be upset about. Nice. And Hasbro, for the most part, you know, was like, look, go for it. You know, they wanted a diverse team that did not have a white male leader. And I could have done it the old fashioned. I could have absolutely done it the way it looked, but I felt that it would have been kind of bland and boring. I figured, let's make a difference. Let's move into the 21st century. And that's what I did. Some people didn't like it. A lot of people did. I saw a lot of young children of all backgrounds very happy to get the Matt Tracker action figure and see the Matt Tracker action figure. Not just black kids. I mean, white kids, Asian kids, Latino kids, kids, you know, in biracial families. I mean, a lot of parents reached out to me personally with the pictures of that figure and how excited their kid got when they saw the announcement. And to me, that's what really counts, ultimately. What the children are thinking, how they feel, not what guys in their 40s and 50s, like myself, you know, it's not about us. Like, it's time for us to hand it over and move on. And we can still love the stuff, but you have to realize we don't own it. And that's how I look at it.
Yeah, that's a really good, just great answer. On that point, I actually, this is something I've been meaning to share on the main show, so I probably will, but I want to now. My friend Keith Hayward, I saw him post on Facebook how like excited, like because he got the figure off of eBay after the mm-hmm. after SDCC, and he told a story about how when he was a kid playing with his mask toys, he would leave the helmet on the Matt Tracker figure and pretend that Matt Tracker was African American because he wanted a character like himself, and now he has that new figure. He can take off the helmet and see someone who looks like him. And I think that's one of the reasons that representation really does matter, not just in big, superhero properties, but also in little, smaller licensed stuff and, just in general. There's a reason representation matters and why it's good to expand that in reboots.
I agree.
Yeah. So, personally, I wouldn't mind if this was something that, sticks, the same way that, I was just thinking of a character. Etta Candy from Wonder Woman, because, she was introduced, they changed her race in New 52, and, that has stuck since, and it's stuck in, some of the wider media, too. So,
yeah.
I certainly hope this is something that, becomes a permanent change.
Well, the figure, when you make an action figure, usually that's the big shift. If they didn't have some positive feeling about it, if they didn't believe in my judgment, at the very least, they wouldn't have committed to making a mold and incurring the cost of creation of that figure. So as far as I know, as far as I'm concerned, it feels to me that they're going to stick with this for the time being.
Yeah. And one thing I always have noticed about, whenever people complained about the Matt Tracker race change was they never brought up Gloria. They never brought up Sly. Right. It's like, so what are you really mad about,
We know how people feel. There's still a element of our country that does not believe that we should move past 1865. So with that being said, there are some people who just, there's a confluence of negative things going on. Some people have their biases that they wear on their sleeve. Other people connect their biases to nostalgia. And once you pull all that together, the immaturity of it all, the anger, the baseless anger, really, you get this very viscerally angry, unreasonable population of fans who just cannot accept anything other than what they imagine in their mind. And they cause nothing but strife. There's nothing positive coming out of any of these conversations about, he's a black guy now. Like, it's always this weird, visceral, illogical, unreasonable anger. And I look at them and I'm thinking, do you really don't have anything else better to do? I get that you want to put your idea out there, but good God, go outside. If it's hurting you that much, just go outside and take a walk, look at the trees and the sky, enjoy yourself. This is not something to start a war over. I don't know. I don't understand any of the anger about character changes, because again, a healthier way of looking at it is understanding who actually owns the property. And even though fans think that they own it, ultimately these corporations do. And until you basically affect their financial bottom line, they're not going to change their opinion, and they're not going to change their policies either. So I think people just have to get over it, to be absolutely honest. They've got to get over it and move on. Seriously.
Yeah, that's the best way to do it. All right. But outside of things like that, there's also just a couple of minor changes, what was sort of your thinking behind changing some of the mask powers or the vehicles? I think the jackhammer is now Julio's vehicle. Mm-hmm. What was sort of the process that you were was it just sort of brainstorming, go into that, please?
Well, okay. See, there's some stuff I probably can't talk about because there's NDA stuff involved in that. I will say this. There were certain vehicles I created and certain powers I created that I was hoping, if the series continued, to tie in to other books, to other concepts that were on the horizon. There's very specific reasons why certain people had certain abilities and drove certain vehicles and so forth and so on. The Cyborg Bruno thing was something I just came up with because I thought it would look cool. I felt that, again, going back to backstory, I felt that Bruno Shepard needed some other reason of being just – I just feel like he needed – Matt Tracker needed another person to lose faith in him other than just, you know, the other members of Venom. And I felt that Bruno and him could have had a relationship. And because of Matt's inaction, it caused a physical deformity. And that would be something that Matt, every time he looked at Bruno in the long run, he would always, you know, kind of blame himself for, almost like the Peter Parker thing, you know. So I kind of looked at it from that perspective because I wanted to have more than just, again, we're evil and we want to fight because we're evil. No, I wanted there to be a reason why Bruno was upset with Matt and something that people could understand, you know, other than just like, well, we're just bad guys. Again, there were a couple of things I had set up for if we had gone into, let's say, issue 12 or 14 or 15, you would see more Transformers show up. You would have seen people from Micronauts show up. And that was my plan. You know, it didn't come true. Didn't happen, clearly. But there were things I had set up that didn't come to pass. So, unfortunately, those reasons will never go explored, unfortunately.
Is there any of those ideas that you had that for future stories that you can share?
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't want to cross that line yet because the final issue of M.A.S.K. Isn't out and First Strike hasn't dropped yet. And generally speaking, I know the IDW editorial management doesn't like us talking about that kind of stuff. So for now, I will say that there were definitely plans for crossovers that tied into the powers, okay. Particularly, let's say, the shrinking powers of certain members. I'll leave it at that. But that's right. As far as I can.
All right, that's fair.
Yeah.
All right. Now, as I said at the top of this interview, you've not only written comics, and you've written several comics, creator-owned, as well as licensed, but you've also written for TV and movies. What are some of the biggest differences and or challenges of writing comics versus writing for the screen?
Well, with comics, you don't really have a budget. And what I mean by that is obviously you have to pay an art team, but you don't have any limitation on what the artist can draw other than the limits of their own imagination. So in a comic book, I could literally blow up the earth 15 times by the third page if I wanted to. But if you do that in a live action film or television series, every second equals a certain tens of thousands of dollars when it comes to special effects. I learned this particularly when I was working on Agent Carter, and there I was talking to the special effects coordinator and design team, and they were going over my script, you know, that episode that I had written, and I had called for something in it, and they had said, well, you know, if we did that, we're talking about, it was like, she said $10,000 or $15,000 a second, per second. And I was like, what? And she was like, yeah. And I was like, oh, well, I guess we're not doing that. And so we had to rewrite a couple of scenes. And once you work on a TV series, animated or live action, and once you're on set, particularly, you know, obviously for live action, and you see where the money goes, it starts to affect how you approach storytelling, because you have to realize that no matter what you think, until you reach a certain level of success, you're always writing toward the budget. And there's ways around that. But in the comics, you don't really think that way. You just hope your artist can, you know, you hope you're writing your script in such a way that the artist understands what you're saying and that they translate it to what it should look like in your brain. That's something that's pretty huge. And that's something that's pretty, that's the hugest difference in my mind about comics and TV and film in terms of scripting. Because in comics, you don't have to be careful. In TV and movies, you definitely do, particularly if your budget is limited.
Right. Yeah. You talked about about writing scripts for your artists. What's sort of been your experience collaborating with the different artists and the colorists on M.A.S.K.?
Well, I mean, I think that there's a huge difference when you're working for a company and you don't have a choice of what artist you get versus when you're doing creator-owned and you personally seek out and recruit your team. First, working with Tony Vargas, was awesome. You know, it was great. He really had a very strong visual sense of what I wanted. So everything I did on the page, he actually brought to life. And I was stunned. So there were certain sequences I was like, there's no way he's going to pull that off. And he did. And that blew my mind. Then we brought in Juan Samu, if I'm pronouncing that right. And his style was a lot different visually than Tony Vargas's. And at first I was like, wow, I'm not exactly 100% on this guy yet. But then when I got the chance to see him do more than just a fill-in issue and him really get, like, he was so good, Juan, that is, was so great at getting the characters' faces. Like, anything I asked for emotionally on their faces, he was able to do. And that's not something a lot of people can pull off. A lot of artists can do tech. A lot of artists can do explosions. A lot of artists can draw really good, you know, fight sequences. But when you got those quiet moments where people are just talking to each other and you want to reveal their inner feelings on their face, and they're not actors, these are just two-dimensional images, not everybody can pull that off. And Juan did that very, very well. So as far as that's concerned, Tony was great at really setting up the mask visuals, and because I had no idea what it was going to look like. And then Juan was really great at character faces. Not to say that Tony wasn't, but Juan was definitely, his stronger suit was getting the character interactions down visually. And I think that was something that that you can't ask for. I mean, that's something that when you get, you just are very happy as a writer. So that's how you approach it. You know, you just hope that the people who you're working with do what you want them to do. And that's all you can ask for.
Yeah. That's definitely something I've found in my own experience working with artists, trying to publish my own comics. It's definitely something I've found is, working closely with the artist is one of the key things to, but you also have to, I feel like at times, let them do, because they're really the director in a lot of
right arts. Right.
That's the thing. Like, you can put, as much detail and like make sure a can of salt is on shelf 3 or something. You could get that specific, but at times right. You just have to, let them do their thing, because they are the ones with the amazing ability to draw that you cannot, or at least I cannot.
right. Yeah. I can't draw either. I can't do anything.
I can draw. I can't draw, but I can at least put some letters together into words.
Right.
All right. Well, I think let's move on to some fan questions. These are questions that were submitted to us through our Twitter and on our thread on theallspark.com. So let's see. Let's first take a couple from Allspark. First up, we have a question from Broadside, one of the editors of the IDW Hasbro Wiki, and friend of the podcast. She's really great. So Broadside writes, why is the shark blue rather than white?
Honestly, I never called for a color of the shark in the script, because I felt honest. Well, the reality is, I know that Hasbro has their ideas about what stuff's supposed to look like, particularly when it comes to vehicle and character design. So honestly, I don't know why it was colored, because sometimes it was gray and other times it was just like a steely blue. That was more of a coloring thing, more so than any instruction I ever put in the script. So honestly, I don't know. You might have to ask Hasbro that.
All right. This one comes from my co-host Callum, or Jally Guy on the Allspark. He was wondering if there was any, because on the Micronauts comic, Cullen Bunn was given certain characters that the movie team that the movie writers over at Hasbro had developed. Were you given any sort of stuff specifically from Hasbro that was make sure you use this, do this character, or?
No, not at all. When I presented my initial roster of Mask and Venom, the only things that came out of Hasbro and more so IDW than Hasbro, was that they wanted them to have a backstory where they were all together in basic training or whatever. And then from there, we built the animosity. So that's why the Revolution one-shot is takes place during the M.A.S.K. boot camp, so to speak. And you got to see the interactions early on and what Mayhem was actually trying to do. Outside of that, I had no kind of mandate about what characters have to show up and which ones don't. So I had a, like I said earlier, I had a kind of a carte blanche as far as that approach was concerned.
All right. This one comes from Shield Agent 47 on the AllSpark. If you could include any Transformer in M.A.S.K., who would it be?
Well, that's great. I mean, Megatron is my favorite Generation 1 character. But that, you know, I had absolutely no access to Megatron because of all the stuff that was going on in the core Transformers books. I would have liked to have brought in Jetfire or Skyfire, whatever you want to call him, because I thought that there was, because M.A.S.K. didn't, I mean, a couple of M.A.S.K. vehicles fly, but they didn't have a flying transport that could take all of them at one time. And I feel that, you know, Jetfire would have been a perfect member as a scientist, because I know that over in the Optimus Prime comic, you know, he has issues with being a scientist and a warrior. And I felt that with M.A.S.K., he could just go all out science and fight every now and then. It would have been Jetfire or Megatron, really. And early on, there was discussions of Cup joining, but Cup was already off doing stuff. And then I was thinking about bringing in Astro Train, but those plans changed and Blitzwing is dead, I guess. And then I was thinking about bringing in Darkwing, but that didn't happen. I mean, there was a lot of stuff I wanted to bring in that didn't happen. But of course, you know, again, the book ends at number 10. So that would have been stuff in issues like 13, 14, 15, 16, you know, down the line. You know? That would have been my plan.
I must say, Darkwing, that's definitely one of the more obscure characters. So I would have liked to have seen that.
Yeah, Darkwing would have come in because I believe Karn killed him. And I had this idea about how – I had this great, like, Watchmen, Alan Moore Watchmen kind of take on Transformers. And Darkwing would have been, I think, central to that, almost like the Rorschach character in the Watchmen films. And much like the Watchmen book and film, it would have been very similar to that. And I wanted to do that very, very badly, but I never got a chance to. So it would have been either Darkwing, Megatron, or Jetfire.
All right. Let's move on to Twitter. We got a lot through Twitter. Yeah, so let's see. This one comes from Gamer Emporium at Gamer Imp. Looking back on M.A.S.K., what is one thing you thought worked better? Or what is one thing that worked better than you thought, and one thing that worked worse?
Well, definitely I really look back at issues 6 and 7 as working a lot better than how I had structured them. Originally, I didn't know if the stories of them would work. And personally, looking back on it, it was some of the strongest work I did character wise. I wanted there to be the one thing I feel personally, this is just me, that it didn't connect the way I wanted to was the vehicular action scenes. There were certain, I wanted it to be a lot more. And as I was writing it, I was looking at how some of the artists were dealing with what I was talking about in terms of the fight sequences. And some of them came off very well. But I think in issue 5, to be absolutely honest, the big battle, I felt that the art team was rushing a bit, and the way I had described things for that big final battle did not come off on the page at all. I wanted it to be more epic with bigger pages, bigger fight sequences. I wanted to recreate a scene from the opening intro of the original cartoon where Matt Tracker's floating through the air with his spectrum energy, almost like wings. And for whatever reason, Tony didn't draw it the way I even gave him reference, and he did not draw it that way, and I was kind of confused about why that didn't happen that way. But I think that the vehicular combat did not come off the way I had wanted it to come off, and I think that would be it. And again, the character work on issues 6 and 7 came off much better than I had anticipated.
All right, this one comes from A.W. Quinn. With the recent 31st anniversary of Transformers the movie, what was it like solving a 30-year-old what-if fan question?
That was a dream come true. I mean, one of the best emails I ever got in my entire career was the invitation to pitch for Transformers Deviations. I'll say that straight up. It was one of the greatest moments ever as a Transformers fan. I was like, I get to... So I pitched actually a bunch of different concepts. Like, I had pitched what if Unicron had destroyed Cybertron. I had pitched what if Ultra Magnus was the chosen one. I had pitched a few different ones, but obviously the number one on that list was what if Optimus Prime didn't die. And the only real issue I had was I only had 20 pages to tell that story when I needed 24. So that was literally one of my greatest moments ever. And it was great. You know, I have nothing negative to say about it. I mean, my only criticism was that I needed 4 more pages. But outside of that, it was a great moment and a great time to be a Transformers fan. I mean, I have nothing but amazing things to say about that. That was fantastic to me.
So I'm curious, was that like, so basically you got to pitch several different things, but they were all movie based. Was that like an IDW constraint?
No, I just felt that Transformers the movie was and is, to me, the pinnacle of Transformers Generation 1 storytelling as far as animation goes, because season 1 of the cartoon was awesome. Season 2 had like a ridiculous number of episodes, and not all of them were great. And, you know, season 3, you know, sometimes I feel the less said about season 3, the better. I feel that the scripts got a little bit more intelligent, but the animation quality dropped hard in season 3. I don't know who that they were hiring. I don't know the backstory, but whoever was paying for that animation to be done, those studios were definitely cutting costs, you know, the animators in season 3. So to have a Transformers story where not only did people die because it's a war, but you had a very dark genocidal war massacre storyline that, quite frankly, you don't get to see in a lot of children's animation outside of Japan, you know. So I feel that Transformers the movie, 1986, to me, is the best and greatest Transformers story ever told in animation so far. And I was just, as a kid who sat in the theater watching it on opening day in 1986 with a bunch of my friends from my old neighborhood, it was like being a kid again. To be able to inject my childhood and that nostalgia onto the screen and into that book, you can't ask for anything better than that, to be absolutely honest. It's just awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Like, Transformers the movie was definitely formative for me because I was past, the time of Generation 1, but my brother had the Transformers, like, he's much older than me, but we had it on VHS. We watched that thing, like, almost every week, it feels like. So that's the thing. Those characters were really my formative experience, like, for Transformers. Springer, Hot Rod, Ultra Magnus, still my favorites. Yeah. So.
Awesome.
Yeah. All right. This one comes from boulderhill.net, one of the mini mask fan sites. They're a great site. Brandon, were there any characters you wanted to include that IDW made you cut? If the series kept going, who else would have been added? So who else would have been added to the Mask and Venom ranks?
They wanted to bring in Cliff Dagger, and they did bring him in for the one-shot annual, the Mask annual that David Rodriguez and Andrew Griffith did. I would have added – I don't know what the code names would have been, but I would have added at least 2 more women to Mask. There would have been obviously crossovers with G.I. Joe, because that's the plan now to basically fold Mask into G.I. Joe. So you may have seen Lady J, Scarlet, or Jinx, and even Storm Shadow, the new female Storm Shadow. In my mind, I definitely would have wanted to bring in characters like that onto Mask and maybe have somebody end up on Venom as well. There's so many characters, though. I didn't want it to get to be Avengers-sized, and I think that's kind of my point, is why I didn't have too many characters up front, because I wanted everyone to get to know them so that when things happen to them, you actually cared. Sometimes, like even with like the Avengers comic, you've got like 40 members of the Avengers, And even these, even though these are Marvel characters I like, I don't really care about them because there's too many people on one page. So I wanted to keep the mask numbers under 10 as long as I possibly could have. So I would have brought women in from G.I. Joe and maybe even Cobra, and I would have either had done a gender swap for some mask characters from the past or just taken women characters who already existed and brought them in and developed them a lot better than the cartoon did. That was my plan.
Oh, nice. Yeah, that definitely would have been interesting to see. This one comes from Primus Prime 22. Hey, Primus.
All right.
Good buddy. Good buddy of mine. Let's see.
Yeah, I love his YouTube page. Love it.
Yeah, if you guys are Transformers fans and you haven't gone to Primus Prime 22 and watched Transformers lore, you totally should. You know, hashtag cheap plug.
Absolutely. Go do it.
Yeah. What writers or other individuals would you say have had the greatest influence on you in your own writing and style?
Well, for film and television, you go back to like old school, like Rod Serling and Patty Chayefsky and Richard Matheson, Norman Lear. There's so many. I mean, I'm a big fan of like 70s filmmakers, 70s era filmmakers, Spielberg, Lucas, Oliver Stone, Francis Ford Coppola, folks like that. In comic books, I would say Warren Ellis is probably my number one writer. I mean, the things that he's been able to do on page, character-wise, his creativity is amazing. Dwayne McDuffie, Christopher Priest, Grant Morrison, Mark Waid. There's a guy out there who is doing the Black Panther animated series now named Jeffrey Thorne, who's been a major inspiration. I would say some of those folks, definitely. A lot of the old school sci-fi, Arthur C. Clarke, Joseph Hadelman, Robert Heinlein, Isaac Asimov, you know, folks like Octavia Butler, you know, people like that, yeah. I would say, huge influences on my storytelling.
All right. And this is going to be our last Twitter question. Does Matt have a son out there with a little robot scooter?
There would be no T-Bob. The only T-Bob I put in was the name of a boat or something like that in one of the issues. But
which then blew up.
Exactly. I hated T-Bob. I think one of the things that kept me from really enjoying the 80s cartoon was T-Bob. I hate it. And I also hate in cartoons, and this is, you know, obviously it's kids' cartoons, but they always stick a teenager in the story just because they need somebody they think that the audience need to identify with. And I don't feel like that's the case because I can watch Transformers. If Transformers, the cartoon, the original one, didn't have Spike or his dad, Sparkplug, I still would have enjoyed that show. They did not need to have humans in it because I don't need to watch. Like, every episode that didn't have humans in it was some of my favorite episodes because I feel like, why are you doing this? You know, you don't need humans in the story. But Scott in the old cartoon was annoying as hell. However, I will say this. I will reveal this. Just like Oliver Queen on Arrow had a son that he didn't realize existed, I was going to have Matt Tracker have a son that he didn't know existed. Ooh. Because remember, he did get in trouble a lot. He traveled the world a lot as a kid. Obviously, he likes women. I mean, he obviously the character was not gay or, you know, but, you know, transgender or anything like that. Or, you know, so he obviously had relations with women in the past. And maybe when he was 19 or 20, he got somebody pregnant and wasn't aware of it. So one of my long-term plans, maybe if we got to issue 25, that would have been a big, because the 25th issue always has to have something crazy in it. My plan was to have Scott Tracker show up. That was my plan. And he would probably be about maybe like 10 years old, maybe, because I never said how old any of these characters were, but I definitely had everybody under 30. So maybe I would have had Matt get somebody pregnant at 17 or 18, and then maybe 10 years down the line, suddenly, because, you know, by issue 25, we'd probably be a few years into the Hasbro universe timeline. So let's say Matt's pushing 30, suddenly a son arrives, and Miles Mayhem knew about the son and was planning to use him and turn him against his dad. So that was a plan that I will reveal because very few people know about it. Not even my editors knew I had this in mind. But my plan was to introduce Scott Tracker, probably around issue 25, as a problem for Matt because this kid hates him but he looks just like Matt. Those are what happens when your child hates you. So, yes, I was going to bring in Scott Tracker much later and without T-Bob.
That actually, I'm not going to lie, that sounds really awesome. Like, I would have loved to have seen that story.
Me too.
Yeah. Alrighty. So before we go, one last question for you. Sure. What are some comics or TV shows? What are some things that you are enjoying right now that you think other people should check out? Be they comics, movies, TV shows, any media you're currently consuming that you would recommend for our listeners?
Sure. I'm really loving the Optimus Prime book that John Barber is doing. It's fantastic. Believe it or not, I say this and some people always react with surprise, but the two main Superman comics in a DC Rebirth have been outstanding.
Oh my God, yes.
I've been telling people this, and people hear Superman and everybody wants to turn their nose up. I'm like, look, those Action Comics and the regular Superman book are two of the best superhero comics being produced right now. Right now. All the people whining about Captain America and whining about this and whining about that. If you want good old-fashioned, real superhero comics with a moral center and an old-school character who's adapted to the times a little bit, read Action Comics and read Superman. They are both awesome. I read a lot of independent stuff. I'm reading a lot of stuff from Titan, the British comic book company. Yeah. I still read Judge Dredd. I read 2000 AD. I'm obviously enjoying the Robotech book from Titan. I'm reading the Warhammer 40K books from Titan. There's a new comic called Cal Exit about what would happen if California seceded from the Union. That's been great to read.
And relevant.
Yeah, stuff. Yeah. I mean, it's an amazing book. There's another book called Black that was a Kickstarter success and just got optioned into a feature-length film. It's about a world where only African Americans have superpowers and what happens when one of those people gets shot by police. That's awesome. Those are probably the books that I am currently reading. I enjoy the James Bond books that Dynamite puts out, but they don't come out all the time. They're like intermittent. But those books have been fantastic too. I really like Rom. You know, I like most of what IDW does. I mean, Rom is a great character, and what Chris Ryall and Christos Gage have done with it has been absolutely amazing. I wholeheartedly recommend those. So I think those are probably the big books that I'm reading right now in terms of comics that I regularly follow. I mean, there's little stuff here and there, but those are probably the biggest books I follow right now, other than the Vampire Hunter D book that I also write.
Yeah. I'm curious. Have you read any of Lion Forge's new stuff? Because they've been putting out some really good stuff.
Oh, yeah. And God forbid, because I still do work for Lion Forge. Yeah, Noble by Brandon Thomas has been outstanding. So great book. Excel has been pretty cool. I've been enjoying that, and Superb just dropped, and I'm looking forward to seeing all the other books, like the incidental titles and the Astonisher title. Pretty much everything that Lion Forge is putting out right now has been fantastic, so I do recommend that if you're, if you want some new superhero books that are not, you know, tied down by damn near 70 to 100 years of continuity, I strongly recommend the Lion Forge stuff on top of the stuff I've already talked about.
Yeah. So, Brandon, where can people continue to follow your work and just you on different social media platforms? Go ahead and plug your stuff.
All right. Well, I've just recently enhanced my Twitter presence. I wasn't really on Twitter a lot over the last couple of years, but in 2017, I've been kind of making Twitter more my home base than anywhere else. So you can find me on Twitter at Brandon Easton, one word. I'm also on Instagram at Brandon Easton Writer, just like it sounds like it's spelled. I'm also on Facebook. I have a Facebook page that I generally, you know, post almost every other day, and I make a lot of announcements about career stuff on there. So just find me on Twitter. On Facebook as Brandon Easton. Matt Tracker is my avatar, so you can't miss my page. And that's about it for now. I will say that on August 18th, of this year, which is, as of right now, 3 days from now, I'm dropping a short film I created, a science fiction short called DDX, Department of Disclosure. That's dropping on August 18th, and that'll be on Vimeo and YouTube. So that'll definitely be all across my social media, and I'm making sure that everybody knows about that. So please check that out. If you like X-Files-style government conspiracies regarding UFOs, you definitely want to check that out. And I have a Star Trek alumni in it, Anthony Montgomery, who played Ensign Mayweather on the Enterprise series, is the main character of my show, of my short film. So nice. Definitely want to check that out when that drops on August 18th.
Well, this episode will be coming out on August 22nd, so that's already out, so our listeners can go and check it out right now. Yeah.
Yeah, that'll be awesome. Yeah, hopefully.
Yeah, so yeah, go check that out. I'm sure we'll link it in our episode description.
Please do.
Yeah. As always, you can find Action and Adventure on Twitter at Hasbro U Podcast. You can find us on Libsyn, iTunes, Google Play, YouTube, wherever podcasts are found. And of course, we have our hosts on our episodes hosted every week on theallspark.com, as well as our forums where you can jump in and discuss, discuss what we've been talking about, and all that, and our Tumblr. And of course, you can find me, Daniel Adkins, on Twitter at Daniel Adkins PRD. You can find me pretty much around on the AllSpark. I edit the TF Wiki and the IDW Hasbro Wiki, which hopefully we can get that up to a better state like the TF Wiki is currently. But yes, everyone, give round of applause once more for Brandon Easton. Thank you so much for joining me on this show, sir.
Man, thank you. And anytime you guys want to talk Transformers, believe me, I can just sit and do that for about 2 hours. So, it's been a pleasure to be here and an honor to talk to you. So thank you so much for your time.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll see you all later.